The focus of this year's forum is replicating success. Our first panel will look at the success factors in cooperative development and how to replicate that success to bring cooperative development to scale. I'd now like to introduce you to Dennis Johnson, President of Cooperative Housing Resources. Dennis will moderate our first presentation on replicating success in cooperative development. Dennis?
Thank you, Gap. Good afternoon, everybody. Appreciate the opportunity to be here today to moderate this panel and to talk about replicating cooperative success. Some of us in this room remember years ago, close to 100 years ago, I suppose, when it first started, how the USDA Extension Service was extensively involved in cooperative development. Growing up on a small dairy farm in East Central Minnesota, my whole life has been cooperatives. We sold our milk to the co-op creamery, we bought our feed from the co-op feed store, our petroleum and fertilizer from the co-op farm supply, we used the co-op locker plant, Doug, we used the cooperative AI company, we used the Rural Electric Cooperative, the cooperative grocery store, and we even had a small 22 farm family cooperative telephone company. And my dad and my uncle were the linemen who maintained it. So we were involved in it. Everything about us was the cooperative. And I remember our local county agent, Don Vollmer, coming out to the farm probably at least once a month to talk about not only the farm operation, but when he was there, it was also the discussion about all of these cooperatives. How were they doing? What did they need? What help could they use? And my grandfather was on several of these boards, so that was all part of the process, but they were very involved. And years later, when I was at the St. Paul campus of the University of Minnesota, the professors and extension people talking about the cooperatives they helped create, or the cooperatives they were working with to help them be successful in the process. This was back in the 70s, and the extensive service that that group provided at that time. For a variety of reasons, we all know that that disappeared, and we were running into a vacuum there for a while. We also had the Rural Electric Cooperatives, the 1935 Rural Electrification Act, and I remember my grandfather talking about how he and Buford Johnson, who ultimately became the manager of the cooperative, traveled the territory to get members to sign up to be part of the Rural Electric Cooperative in East Central Minnesota. And it was successful. They did it. We had lights. I don't remember not being without lights. I do remember being without running water, but not being without lights. And of course, the credit unions and all of the work that went into replicating that process, groups of individuals coming together with a common interest to provide the kind of financial services that they needed in rural areas, in organizations, as worker groups, unions, etc., all part of that. By the time we got to the late 1980s, early 1900s, as you know, the agricultural economy was in a crisis. There was considerable volatility in the rural economy. Rural communities were disappearing. And one of our great co-op visionaries from the Midwest, an inductee into the Hall of Fame, by the way, Rod Nilsestoon, worked with some of us to convince us to be part of a group to look at how do we get the resources that rural communities need. And we created the National Rural Cooperative Development Task Force. We probably had a group of about 100-150 individuals from throughout the United States as part of that group, providing support, writing letters, building support, raising money, all about getting a replacement, if you will, or a replication for what used to be the Extension Service. Out of that came the Rural Cooperative Development Grant Program. It wasn't as large as we wanted, but that's probably to be expected when you're dealing with the legislators and congressmen in the process. But we were able to put that to work. We created the Cooperative Development Centers, and Kevin is going to talk a little bit more about that in his comments, but it was a way of replicating or building, providing the resources needed for replicating cooperative development, cooperative success, both initial development and operating resources once they're up and running. I want to take a couple minutes to specifically talk about replicating success in the senior cooperative housing sector that we have in the Midwest. The first senior housing cooperative, as we know it in the Midwest, opened in 1978. It was sponsored and developed by the Ebenezer Society, an organization that provided long-term care to seniors. And as might be expected, they didn't start with any kind of a small project at all. It was a 338-unit cooperative that they sold to the members, constructed, and operated. And interestingly enough, Ebenezer is still the management company of that cooperative today. These are all independently owned and controlled cooperatives. Now, there's a lot of senior housing cooperatives, but most of them that we talk to, particularly on the two coasts, have developers or management companies involved as board members or owners of the organizations. That's not true in any of the cooperatives in the Midwest. The cooperative was funded under Section 213 of the National Housing Act. HUD insured master mortgage on the project. The first six senior housing cooperatives in the Midwest were actually started by non-profit organizations. Ebenezer, Episcopal Church Homes, Presbyterian Homes, Calvary Lutheran Church, all got those organizations going, and in all cases, they were big cooperatives by today's standards. They were 200, 300, 150-unit cooperatives. That group then kind of disappeared, and in the mid-late 1980s, Real Life Inc. came about. Real Life Inc. was started by Dave Hansen and his wife Marion, both of whom had been part of the original 7500 York project. Marion had been involved in marketing it to the members, and Dick was the construction superintendent for Borson, the contractor that built the building. They moved to the rural areas, New Ulm, Minnesota, Waseca, Minnesota, Owatonna, Minnesota, Columbus, Nebraska, Denison, Iowa, and began that business of nonprofit development. And over the years, that has changed somewhat, but today we have five for-profit developers working in developing senior housing cooperatives. About that same time, in the early 1990s, Rod Nielsen-Stoon and the executive director of CDF, John Gauci, proposed the idea of looking at a way for developing these on a more practical, a more replicating way to do it, working with rural communities and helping them develop these on their own. And out of that process came Homestead Housing Center, which we started in mid-1995. We raised funding from the St. Paul Bank for Cooperatives, the Farm Credit Bank, Senex at the time, Great River Energy, who am I missing? Farmland, MSI Insurance, all big part of the of Homestead Housing Center. And over the next 7 or 8 years, Homestead Housing Center developed 17 senior housing cooperatives in rural areas representing 151 units. And all but one of those 17 are still operating as a senior housing cooperative. One of them converted to a kind of condominium project. But Homestead Housing Center ceased to exist, and we found out that that process was costly, it was time-consuming, and it was a difficult and relatively unsuccessful process of trying to develop senior housing cooperatives from the ground up. Most cooperatives are developed by the consumers, the users, the people that are going to own and operate it. This became a very complicated process to do in that manner. And we have surmised that it was probably due to the fact that these people are going to live in this building. So there was a lot of different ideas on what and how it should be done, disagreements on how it should be done, successful starts and stops and changes. And so it eventually liquidated the organization. But out of that came, again, a reinforcement of the for-profit developer group. And as of today, we now have 104 senior housing cooperatives of this model primarily in the upper Midwest. We do go down into Bella Vista, Arkansas. Of course, there's one in Washington, Silver Glen in the state of Washington. But 104, representing almost 6,600 living units, just a little shy of 6,600. The smallest cooperative is 10 units. The largest is 337. We estimate that there's about 9,500 to 10,000 seniors living in these buildings right now. So it is a sizable group of individuals, but small compared to the over 19 million seniors eligible to live in, agent-wise, eligible to live in one of these organizations. Minnesota and Iowa alone have 1.1 million individuals over 65 years old, and we have only 10,000 individuals living in these cooperatives. As I said, they're done by for-profit developers. It's an extensive process. I was telling somebody earlier, the developers have to really know, understand, and appreciate the result, because this can be a 2 to 5 year process, and you're convincing 80-year-old widows to move out of a house they've lived in for 60 years, take on a monthly payment, and to buy this little red dot on a schematic that we hope you can move into in about 2 or 3 years. So you have to convince them and then keep them convinced, keep them involved, keep them participating all along. These are generally financed under Section 213 of the National Housing Act, the HUD Insured Master Mortgage. Of these 104, there's 23 that do not have a master mortgage. None of the homesteads had a master mortgage, which we found was another challenge in terms of sales. We've also found it's a bigger challenge in terms of operating today, in terms of resale of membership shares, and in terms of maintaining some of the original provisions that were laid out as part of the cooperative. Under the HUD insured master mortgage, all of these cooperatives have replacement reserves. They have general operating reserves that they build up to at least 20% of the budget for cash flow requirements. Financially, they're very strong. Initial share payments are anywhere from 40 to 50% of the unit values, so the loan to value ratios are 50 to 60%. Very limited credit risk in any of these organizations. And none of the senior housing cooperatives in this group have ever defaulted on a mortgage payment. We just completed our 2015 survey of the senior housing cooperatives. This is our second time for doing it. And one of the components or characteristics that we firmly believe in is that seniors live longer, healthier lives in senior housing cooperatives. And a big part of it is the ongoing day-to-day social participation and involvement and the active governance of these operations. I mean, you're talking 85, 90-year-old individuals on the board of directors running multi-million dollar businesses. They live in them, but they're multi-million dollar businesses that they're setting the policies, the guidance, the budgets, doing the maintenance decisions, et cetera, all as part of that. We have confirmed again that over 50% of the seniors living in these buildings are 80 years or older. And about 15 to 18% are over 90 years old. And in this last survey, we had three individuals living independently that are over 100 years old in these buildings. So it's clearly a model for older individuals, a successful model. Expansion has been slow to move it outside of that area. We are making some progress, if you will. We are making some progress in that area, if you will. We currently have, or currently aware of, 24 prospective cooperatives under development. Again, mostly in the upper Midwest, but you'll notice green dots down in Kansas and Missouri now that were not there before. We have a couple of developers moving into that area. Of course, Iowa and Minnesota continuing to be the major areas for development. So it is working, and we've been very pleased with what we've been able to do with it. We have a couple of support items as part of that. I mentioned Homestead Housing Center. A big part of making Homestead Housing Center work was with assistance financially from Cooperative Development Foundation in terms of day-to-day operations and funding development projects in the local communities. We also, a few years ago, received a grant from the MSC Fund for the feasibility study of a purchasing cooperative. And we're now in our fifth year of SCH purchasing cooperative. It's a purchasing cooperative for senior housing cooperatives. We have 17 members and purchasing programs in appliances, lighting, flooring, office supplies, TV, telephone, internet, all as a way of helping these organizations save expenses and be more successful in meeting the needs of their members. It's working, we're excited. I can speak for hours on this topic. If anybody has any questions, I'd be glad to speak with you afterwards, because we have a couple of practitioners to hear from today in terms of, replicating cooperative success. And first is Kevin Edberg, Executive Director of Cooperative Development Services, who's going to talk about several of these areas from his perspective. Kevin?
Many of us, I suspect, from our grade school years will recall in 1492, Columbus sailed the ocean blue. It's a little rhyme that helps us remember when Christopher Columbus left Spain in the Niña, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria. He, of course, discovered the New World and opened up the riches of North America, Central America, and South America. We repeat what we have been told often enough, and we come to believe that we know that this is true. Except in this case, the story is not completely true. In 1961, excavations at Lance au Meadow, the northern tip of Newfoundland, uncovered the remains of eight house wood frame timber and peat sod houses, a forge, and four workshops, all dating to the 11th century, proving that Scandinavians were in fact the first Europeans to settle in the United States, in North America. But even that story isn't completely true, because the place where they settled, it has been shown, has been the site of human habitation by indigenous people dating back 5,000 years. The Norwegian author Carl Ove Nausgaard, in his book My Saga Part 2, framed a fascinating question. He wrote, "The really interesting thing about the Vikings, therefore, wasn't that they discovered America, but that they left it without a trace. What if Columbus had done the same? I thought," he writes, "what if the authorities in Europe at the end of the 15th century, when Columbus informed them of what he had seen and experienced, decided to leave America alone, not to conquer it, not to colonize it, not to exploit it? It is inconceivable. If there is something to be gained, if it is gainable, no power on earth can restrain the forces that seek to gain it. To leave a profit or a territory or any kind of resource or even a scientific discovery unexploited is deeply alien to human nature." I use this story and this insight about the nature of our species as a means of framing to you today why I believe it matters for us to gather today to reflect on the work of the Cooperative Development Foundation, to reflect on the achievements of our heroes and to honor their contributions to our community and our wider world, why it matters for us to see and understand our progress in bringing cooperative development to scale in the United States, and why it matters for each of us to commit ourselves to the ongoing and unfinished work of expanding the application of the cooperative business model and meeting the needs of individuals and communities in the 21st century through the creation of an authentic cooperative community. So I pose the question to you, what is at stake in this conversation? And I'd like to begin by telling you I consider myself a capitalist. I appreciate the role of markets in the allocation of resources. I honor the hard work of entrepreneurs who bring to us better mousetraps. And I honor the work of business people who day in and day out go about the ethical practice of their trade in their communities. But more and more in America today, I say to you, we practice a perverted form of capitalism. We practice a form of capitalism that enriches the few at the expense of the many. We practice it in a way that creates extractive economies that strip equity and resource from our communities. Need I remind you, if you want some evidence, let me give you three little tidbits. Let me remind you that the best and brightest of our Ivy League schools were hired by Wall Street firms to create instruments to slice and dice mortgages and bring the world economy to its knees. Perhaps lesser known is that Wall Street trading houses located their businesses closer to exchanges, not so that they could unlock the value, the productive value of capital, but so that they could send those little packets of electrons so that they would arrive at the exchanges moments in advance of their competitors, thus triggering a whole cascade of electronic performance that made and broke markets, creating wealth for them, gaming the system, but having absolutely no impact on the creation of jobs or enhancing the productive use of capital. And it seems we can barely go a week without reading about the fines instituted by the SEC or some other regulatory entity in the tens or hundreds of millions of dollars for the behavior, the unethical, illegal behavior of our largest financial firms. Something is very wrong. And like our understanding of Christopher Columbus, the Nina, the Pinta, and the Santa Maria, all that we tell ourselves about the vaunted goodness of our American practice of the free enterprise system, well, you know, it's just not all quite true. And as Karl Ove Knausgård makes clear, our basic human instinct is to exploit. Of all of the business structures that we use in America today, our business model is the only one that comes with a recognized set of values and principles that guide its use. We are part of a recognized global community that attempt to put those practices and values on the ground in the work of everyday life. In an age where I believe the unequal distribution of wealth is the issue of our time, and in a period of human history when we are almost most assuredly going to add another 2 billion people to this planet, further straining with all of the resulting claims on natural resource of our planet, I suggest to you that the world needs to know more about things that we know about. And I suggest to you that it matters that we bring what we know to the world and that we bring it to the world at scale. And that is why I am pleased and honored to be among you today. I have three objectives. First, I want to tell you about the three major approaches to cooperative development in the United States that I'm seeing, to give you some examples of each, and to provide some observations and perhaps identify some lessons learned in that process. But before I talk about our approaches to cooperative development, I want to put some context around that. I want to provide some information on how the rest of the business community gets its work done. And for that, we go to the Small Business Administration and its system of small business development centers. That system is supported by $115 million of federal expenditure. That's augmented by an additional $115 million of non-federal cash and in-kind support, delivered through 64 programs in every state. Some states have more than one, and our territories. Staffed by 4,500 people in almost 1,000 locations throughout the nation. That funding, by the way, does not reflect, that's the TA portion of the Small Business Administration. It does not reflect dollars for loans, for other capital investments in our systems. But here's the kicker. That's actually not quite true. I overstated. They are willing to work with us, so long as they ask all of our members to make personal guarantees on the business, unlike any other capital structure that they invest in. The folks at SBA freely admit that they do not understand our model of member use, member finance, member governance. They don't know how to deal with us. And so our opportunities go unaddressed by that system. Now I want to take a moment. Chuck Snyder, are you in the audience? I want to call out the National Cooperative Bank, Chuck Snyder, for championing work today, as well as Mike Bell and his predecessor Paul Hazen at NCBA for taking on this policy question of how do we begin to unlock the resources of SBA and bring those resources to our community too. It's a needed work, and I thank them for doing that. So then how is this system developing for cooperative development in the United States? And I see kind of three parts. It's a dynamic system. I may not see all of it, but I'm going to suggest that one part of it is the emergence of cooperative development centers on the ground, around the country, working primarily in rural areas, funded by the USDA Rural Cooperative Development Grant Program. That's one leg. A second leg, some of our sectors have intentionally initiated growth strategies to grow and support the development of cooperative enterprises, both their existing ones as well as new ones. And finally, we see an emerging set of nonprofit organizations who see the value of the cooperative model and seek to bring that to the populations that they work with. I'm going to describe one. Hilary will have some more. So let me talk just a moment about this RCDG-funded system. The first leg is this program, which Dennis told you was created in response to the ag crisis of the 1980s. It's the living legacy of NCBA's policy initiative, the National Rural Cooperative Development Task Force. It was led at that time by Lee Ruth of California and Rod Nilsestoon of Wisconsin. And both of them are members of the Cooperative Hall of Fame today, at least in part because of the leadership that they showed in rallying the cooperative community to enact this policy initiative. I want to take just a side note. I would be remiss not to recognize the role that Dennis Johnson played in supporting that and being a part of that effort. And two of our honorees tonight also have their connection. Judy Z. Watts was the staff member of that National Rural Development Task Force, and she was the one who, on the ground and in the trenches, shepherded that initiative through Congress, in and amongst a number of other significant contributions that she has made to our cooperative community. In her role as the executive director of the Cooperative Development Foundation, she was the first individual or the first entity to package the very first RCDG application on behalf of a handful of cooperative development organizations when that program hit the ground. One of those centers at that time was Cooperative Development Services, the organization that I have the privilege of leading. We celebrate our 30th anniversary this July. One of our incorporators was one Ann Adele Hoyt. So we have great leadership in our room today. Under the RCDG program, USDA was tasked with the creation of a national network of cooperative development centers to support the creation and growth of rural cooperatives and businesses. I want you to think about perhaps as the SBDCs for cooperatives. Today, the funding is at about $5.8 million. It's a competitive grant program, one-year annual grants, about $200,000 per organization funded to 30 organizations around the country. It's for organizational and business development assistance. It's a good thing, and it's a nascent. It's all something that we've had only in the last 15 years. If there's a downside, we don't have a nationally coordinated national system. It works in rural communities only. And we have no national strategy, at least no actionable national strategy right now for bringing that to the next level of making sure that all Americans have access to this kind of support. Cooperation Works is a voluntary member organization that today serves as the de facto network of cooperative development centers. It has about 25 organizations, mostly rural, not all. A growing number of urban development organizations join us, and we are trying to get really good at our craft. This map represents states where one of our member organizations serves at least some portion of that. Some of the shaded areas represent served areas. We are in the process of releasing our most recent survey of our results. Over the past 3 years, our centers, 26 responding centers, indicated that they had served over 4,700 total clients served, including over 2,200 cooperatives. 374 new businesses had been started, including 140 new cooperatives. Over 1,100 new co-op jobs were created and 1,300 cooperative jobs saved, and a total of over 4,500 total jobs created or saved during that 3-year period. All right, that's in and amongst the additional education, networking, and other kinds of services performed by this system. In addition, these centers serve as ways of extending the resources of the federal government and other places out into the countryside, working with rural businesses and communities. If you are a rural electric, you might recognize the Rural Economic Development Loan and Grant Program. Or if you are a farmer-owned farm supply co-op or in the farm credit system, you might recognize the value-added producer grant program or the small socially disadvantaged grant program, farmer-owned value-added programs. In total, our centers have helped leverage over $22 million of federal resource for our clients over the last 3 years. So I'm going to make one little post-it note here. If you are here from the rural electric community, the farm supply, the farm credit system, I want you to think back to that little map. You have a network in your backyard of centers who are capable of supporting your members and your borrowers. And one of the unfinished pieces of business that we are about is to try and knit together how can the talents and expertise and the abilities of these developers be brought more intentionally to bear in support of your sectors. And we would welcome the strategic conversations at a national level to make that happen. So I want to shift away from the Rural Cooperative Development Grant Program and talk about one of the sectors that has conscientiously chosen to have a development strategy. There are several that I could have chosen. I know NASCO is here in the room, National Association of Student Cooperatives, and their strategy for student housing. But I'm going to talk about food co-ops. It's a fun and wonderful story. So the first wave of cooperative food co-op development in the United States occurred during the Great Depression. People aggregated their purchasing resources so they could get food at a more affordable cost. The second wave began in the 1970s and 80s as more and more consumers sought out natural and organic foods as a means of the way that they chose to feed themselves and their families. And they needed to aggregate, they needed to find that food because it wasn't available in their local grocery stores. And so we started a lot of co-ops. Not all of them made it. The ones that survived were either lucky or good. But the fact is they were all isolated and operating pretty much by themselves. In the late 1990s, National Cooperative Bank extended a loan to cooperative development services that facilitated the work of Walden Swanson and Kate Sumberg in the creation of a financial benchmarking tool called COCOFIST, Common Cooperative Financial Statements. That tool allowed managers and leaders of co-ops to compare their practices and to compare their operating results. And when they did that, even though those results were initially masked, they started saying, Who's up at the top of that list? And what are they doing, and what is allowing them to be so successful? And it created a conversation around good, better, and best practices. And the whole sector started to engage, first in regional pods, later in a national, revitalized national organization. And later after that, that national organization, powered by its own purchasing cooperative to aggregate the purchasing power of its member cooperatives. Indeed, after that, that organization today is known as the National Cooperative Grocers, NCG. They also have created their own development cooperative to assist in the financing and technical assistance that have allowed their members to open new stores and to grow stronger in their business and operations. But along about this time, about 12 years ago, early 2000s, a strange thing started happening. People started getting phone calls from communities saying, I want a food co-op in my town. We hadn't seen that, in some cases, in 2 decades. And the third wave of cooperative development in the food co-op sector was created. As that wave grew and grew, we needed to get smarter and better at how we figured out how to respond to those inquiries. National Cooperative Bank convened a table of food co-op leaders here in DC. And out of that was born a program that came to be known as the Food Co-op 500 program. And that's began developing tools and information for these communities wanting food co-ops. We created a model to help guide the efforts in local communities nationwide to give them best practices and tips on better ways to develop their cooperatives in their own communities. And finally, we helped create a nonprofit food co-op initiative devoted solely to the national support of food co-op startups. We've had some tremendous success. The top line is the total number of startups open. Since we began tracking with Food Co-op 500, we've had about 100 food co-ops start in the United States. They haven't all succeeded. The dark blue line, or kind of the purple line, I guess, the second line down, are the closures, the ones that didn't make it. But astoundingly, we've had over a 70% success rate in the startup of these businesses, and I will tell you that that compares very well to the survival rate of small businesses in the United States. So you put these systems together. The development cooperative has assisted their own members, the second wave, if you will, in the development of their systems, opening new stores. They've opened 30 new co-ops or new storefronts and grown the existing capacity of existing ones. Food Co-op Initiative has assisted in the creation of about 100 new startups, about a 70% success rate. Those startups today are owned by over 90,000 owner members. They have created over 1,000 jobs in communities across the United States, generating sales of about $150 million. Now, I also want to make clear, those 30 co-ops started by the DC, they probably are generating far more than $150 million. New startups, because of the lack of access to capital and the constraints of startup, usually open stores that are smaller than what their communities will support. But nonetheless, this is a tremendous story of success. And we still have more than 100 communities across the United States today that have an active steering committee asking themselves the question, can we have a food co-op in our town? So let me switch gears now and talk about that third emerging strand of cooperative development at scale. And here's where we're seeing nonprofit organizations seeing the value of the cooperative model and bringing that to communities that they are related to and care about. I'm going to talk about Rock USA. Beginning in about 1984, the New Hampshire Community Loan Fund began looking at issues related to the stability of housing in manufactured home parks. What you may or may not know is that in a manufactured home park, the resident owns owns their unit, their residence, but they do not own the underlying land that residence sits on. That makes them particularly vulnerable if that land increases in value or if the owner chooses to sell for whatever reason, those homes are at risk. And so the New Hampshire Community Loan Fund began this process of looking at how can we stabilize those lives through the conversion to limited equity cooperatives. And it's been a phenomenal story. In that state, between 1984 and 2000, they completed 89 conversions. 25% of all of the manufactured home communities in New Hampshire today are cooperatively owned, and none have ever gone into default. Coming out of that experience, the New Hampshire Community Loan Fund sought out some additional partners, including Capital Impact Partners and others, to form a national effort to bring this model to greater greater number of places. Excuse me, I forgot to tell you, one of the things that they learned, and that was the reason to take this to scale, was that the resident-owned communities, the ROCs, they sold those units when they came for sale, sold faster, they sold at higher prices per square foot, and within 3 years of conversion, the carrying costs in those units lagged the market, were lower than comparable units in other places. We were creating value through, that's the cooperative difference, creating value through our cooperative action. So there are several key structures to know about inside of the ROC USA model. There's the ROC USA network. That's the national entity that actually steers and guides the organization and its efforts. There are regional certified technical assistance providers, CTAPs, that are trained and under contract to the network to provide support on the ground in specified geographic communities. And there's the ROC USA Capital, which is a community development financial institution that aggregates capital to support the financial needs of projects developed by the CTAPs. Now, I mentioned this role of the CTAPs. They're receiving training from the network. They enter into a long-term agreement. They identify park owners that are interested in selling, and then it's their job to work, do the on-the-ground community organizing to support the creation of the community, of the cooperative, and to bring that deal to close. The system is funded in a number of ways. There is a closing fee that basically, the CTAPs are on the hook for most of their upfront development time. They have a great incentive to get to closure, all right? Because there's a closing fee that's affiliated with that. There's also a very large amount of financing that's gone into this real estate activity, and that throws off some interest earnings. And those interest earnings support the national effort and some of the work of the CTAPs. But nonetheless, there is still some gaps that typically remain, that need to get filled by other sources. So what has that network achieved? To date, they have 8 CTAPs working in 22 states, 78 additional new cooperative conversions since 2008, with just under 5,000 units of housing converted. They've leveraged $172 million, with ROC USA Capital providing more than $93 million of that. Wow. A tremendous story of success, and all of that's happened in less than the last decade. That's what happens when we get smart about how we bring things to scale. So I'd like to close with some observations. I've given you 3 stories. Dennis gave you another one. All right? I want to try and pull out a small number of things of what do we take home from this? What might be some lessons for us to think about? First one is, I want to hold up that there has been a significant growth in the professionalism of this practice. Cooperative development is a professional practice. We have to know and understand some things about the work, and we've gotten much better at it. It's come in a relatively short period of time. The on the ground, being local and accessible to individuals, that's the role of this RCDG-funded center process. It's making impacts, it's come a long way, we still have a ways to go. One of the key things that I would point out, we have not managed to find the champions to allow us to bring that talent to urban communities. That's a problem that we need to fix. Second one is that for us to bring these systems to scale requires focus and at least some levels of standardization. My friend Melissa Hoover likes to talk about worker co-ops and how each entity thinks of themselves as their own special snowflake. I love that phrase, that image. And there's always this tension between what does standardization require versus what are the needs of our individual owner members. That's a tension. It's a healthy tension most times, but it's there, and we have to figure out how to deal with it. But that standardization allows us to achieve efficiencies in training and facilitates financing and a variety of other things. The third one, all of our development systems require subsidy. Just like SBA is not self-sufficient, they require $230 million to have the system that they have. We should not feel abashed by saying we need subsidy to carry this work out. Now, how much and how we get it? Open question. But there's always a need for some of it to come from somewhere. Right now, the RCDG is our primary source of funding for that, and we are vulnerable because of that. We're vulnerable to political winds. I think there would be some real value for us to further explore the ROC USA experience of linking aftercare technical assistance to financing. I think if we were to more strategically link to our colleagues in the Rural Electric and Credit Union and Farm Credit Systems, there may be some deal flow and some efficiencies that we could capture that way. But I would also say that an access to cooperative charity would also be a welcome thing. Our cooperatives are wonderful and generous bodies. They live out that seventh principle every day. And I'm not asking or suggesting that everybody take all of their money and support development. Nah. But could I challenge the leaders that are in this room to go home and look at your cooperative philanthropy and find out how much of it do you give that supports this development in your region or in your sector? Might we achieve 10%? It still leaves you 90% to give to your fire departments and everything else that you want to support. That's a good thing. But I at least put that on the table as something to think about. I think we do have significant opportunities for our existing sectors to align with this emerging capacity. I've already spoken about that. And finally, public policy matters. That's really not a surprise, it's always matter. And Des talked about the extension service and all of the other systems that we have. None of our mature cooperative sectors arrived Venus on the half shell, all right? We all had a start somewhere. One of those places, advocacy, your support in advocating for the Rural Cooperative Development Grant Program. Your support for the work of NCBA and others in calling for reform of the SBA and the opportunities to engage and benefit from their resources. Dennis mentioned the HUD section, it's actually 213 blanket mortgage program. When a center in Minneapolis, a HUD center, was threatened with closure and consolidation, all of the talent that understands that model was at risk. We managed to avoid that. In New Hampshire, one of the things that made the New Hampshire Loan Fund successful was that there was a state law that said landowners, before they could sell their partners, had to give the right of first refusal, the opportunity to their tenants to buy the co-op. And that language exists in a couple of other states. There's also some tax incentives that are used in still others to encourage the owners of land to facilitate the sale to their residents. So this area of public policy is a ripe one, and we all need to be hands on board. So with that, let me end where I began. In a world of economic segmentation and exploitation, with the increasing demands on the carrying capacity of our planet, we need to do and live our lives differently. We who practice cooperation know something that the rest of the world needs to know. And we bring that to them in the day-in, day-out operations of our cooperatives, and in our support for bringing this model to more and more communities in more and more ways. Our model is not just another business model. Done rightly, practiced honorably, our model is a just model. Our sectoral strategies to grow the breadth and reach of our cooperative sectors, they matter. Our efforts to support regional cooperative development organizations back where we live, they matter. Our intentions to work across sectoral lines within the cooperative community to bring our talents and share our resources so that we can be even more effective, they matter. Our gatherings and our conversations, such as today and tonight, to honor our heroes and to recognize their achievements, they matter. And for your efforts, the work that you do every day in bringing and practicing cooperation in your communities, they matter. And I thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you, Kevin. For those interesting and inspiring and thought-provoking comments. We're going to hold questions until after both of our presenters have completed. Our second practitioner is Hilary Abell from ProjectEquity. Oops, I'm having trouble with this today. And we're pleased to have her here today to talk about the success in worker cooperatives. Hilary?
Good afternoon, everyone. How's everybody doing? Good, good. I don't know about you, but I feel a need for a little bit of movement. Could people raise their hands if you're involved with, let's start with agricultural cooperatives? Wonderful. How about rural electric cooperatives? Okay, we've got a few, good. Food cooperatives? Excellent. Worker cooperatives? Okay, what am I missing? Housing cooperatives? Okay, yell it out if I'm missing something else. Credit unions, of course, yes, welcome. Good, multi-stakeholder, fabulous. Wonderful, well, welcome everybody. It is a real honor for me to be here today. I got my start in worker cooperatives about 20 years ago as a worker owner at Equal Exchange. And when I look back 20 years, I'm also very aware that that's about half the time that many people in this room have been involved in working with cooperatives. So that's very humbling, and it truly is an honor to be speaking to you today. One of the highlights of my time at Equal Exchange was working in producer relations. So I got to visit farmer cooperatives in Peru, Colombia, and El Salvador, and that lit a fire under me because I saw how the cooperative itself brought people together in a way that they could cut out that middleman who was taking so much of what profit there was in their value chain. They could sell directly to international buyers, even better on fair trade terms, to companies like Equal Exchange. And they took that premium and invested it in their communities, in healthcare and education, and in adding value to their production. Then meanwhile, back in the United States, I was a salesperson also, selling fair trade coffee to restaurants and universities and cafes and stores, and of course, food cooperatives. And seeing the way that the food cooperatives embraced and supported and helped build the fair trade movement, and being at that worker co-op that was in the middle of that relationship between the farmer co-ops and the food co-ops in another country, was incredibly inspiring. So principle six, cooperation among cooperatives, started to come alive for me way back then. I started in worker co-op development in 2003 when I joined the staff of Wages. The organization is now rebranded as Prospera, but the old acronym stands for Women's Action to Gain Economic Security. And maybe you can see in the pride and the peer leaders, that's a picture on the lower right from our peer leadership program, the pride and the security and empowerment that those women were feeling through their participation in the green cleaning cooperatives that Wages was developing. I'm going to tell you about just one of those women. She's the fourth from the right in that picture, Berta Naranjo. She was born in California, but spent most of her childhood in Mexico, where her parents were from. As a teenager, she moved back, didn't have a high school education, and started working as a farm worker in the fields. Starting at 3 a.m., working under the hot sun, you can imagine what those working conditions were like. When she had her children, she even had to bring them into the fields with her some days because she couldn't afford childcare. Her other alternatives, the other work she had, were dead-end retail jobs, some independent house cleaning, and she actually got quite sick from working with those toxic cleaning chemicals all day long. So when she heard that Wages was starting a new eco-friendly cleaning cooperative in Morgan Hill, partnering with a local social service agency, she became one of the founding worker owners. She not only learned about business, learned about herself, and her own leadership skills started to emerge, but she got trained as a trainer and became one of the people who taught the highly professional and sophisticated eco-friendly cleaning techniques that these businesses were using to hundreds of women, not only the newcomers in her own cooperative, but all the trainees and new founders and new members of the co-ops that Wages developed later. So I did this work for 8 years and found it very inspiring, especially when we got down to really tracking data. So as you'll see later, there's not a lot of data on the impact of worker cooperatives. But there is some, and Wages, thanks to a grant we had from the Ms. Foundation back in 2003, started a very rigorous annual impact study. The first year I was there, it showed that the women in Bertha's cooperative, their incomes had increased so much that their family income of the whole family had gone up by 44%. So once I saw that and the impact it was having on these families, again, it lit a fire under me. So a few years later, when I left, in 2011, I left Wages and was really excited and driven to figure out how to take that kind of work into more industries, to more kinds of people, and to more low-wage workers who really badly need better options for their hard work and better rewards. So I had the luxury of spending some time writing this paper, and if anyone's interested in hard copies, I have a few with me today. It'll be up on CDF's website and is also on Project Equity's website. The reason I wrote it and spent about 2 years, if any of you have published a big thing like that, it takes a long time, always longer than you think, and interviewed 15 colleagues across the country and finally had some time to dig in and look at what data was out there. The reason I did it was I wanted to sort of know for myself, first of all, what really is the impact of this beyond the one example that I knew well. And I also wanted to put out some of the hard-won lessons learned from 20, 30 years of worker co-op development experience in this country. Even though there weren't that many examples, there were some very sophisticated and important lessons learned. And after the Great Recession, whether it was Occupy Wall Street protesters, or more recently I just learned that Scott Walker, Republican from Wisconsin, was Justin Mondragon. So the interest in worker ownership there's been a huge groundswell since the crash of the economy and so many people realizing that the way we're approaching it isn't working for a lot of people. So I wanted to put out the lessons that had been learned to some of the new and kind of intermediate practitioners that hadn't yet had the benefit of that experience. Today I'm going to share with you a brief snapshot of the worker co-op sector in our country today and a few more stories. I'll lay out the five distinct approaches to development that seem to be fairly common across the country these days, and a series of 10 success factors that I kind of culled from talking to people and really reviewing these different cases of success. And then, like Kevin did, I want to take a few moments just to say why this kind of cooperative development matters and the opportunity that we have to make a difference for some of the most disadvantaged workers. And finally, a vision into what are some of the new and exciting things happening and what's next and how we might start to live out that cooperation among cooperatives a little bit more. So there are about 300 to 400 worker co-ops across the country today. It's not nearly as many as we'd like. We're by far the smallest part of the cooperative community. We are in many different industries. As you can see, service and retail are very common. There's a nice chunk in manufacturing. Some of that is advanced manufacturing, like Isthmus Engineering and Madison. And a lot of it is actually food manufacturing. And then there's many other industries as well. We're all over the country, concentrations in certain areas, of course, but we're in many different parts of the country. A solid one-third of these cooperatives have been around more than 20 years, so there is a lot of stability and steady growth over time of those older businesses. And yet, 60% of today's worker cooperatives were formed since 2000, and half of those were formed since 2010. So again, we have this groundswell of new interest and participation in this model. Melissa Hoover shared at the roundtable yesterday on cooperative conversions, that some 42% of existing worker cooperatives actually weren't started up as cooperatives. They were nonprofits or they were privately held businesses and then converted. So you'll hear later about a groundswell of activity around worker co-op conversions that's very exciting. And finally, these co-ops are increasingly racially and ethnically diverse. So it's not for nothing. Our country is also that way. And in fact, we will be a majority minority country in about 30 years. Already my own state of California, and I think it's 5 or 6 states now, are majority minority states. So worker co-ops aren't alone in this, but we may be a little bit ahead of the curve. It turns out that of co-ops developed in the last few years, the new ones starting up, the majority of participants are actually people of color. Latino immigrants are a big part of that upswing, but it's African Americans and other people of color as well. I'm just going to give a few more snapshots of the range of successful worker co-op development that's been done. I imagine most people in the room have heard of Cooperative Home Care Associates. They are a 2,300 employee business that is far and away a leader in the creation of quality jobs that lead to quality care for low-income, elderly, and disabled people in New York. They have 2,300 employees, two-thirds of them are worker owners, they've been around about 30 years. And not only do they have above industry wages, but when you go in there, if you ever have a chance to visit the Bronx and see their training program or go and meet the CEO, Michael Elsass, if you go into his office, you'll see a number of worker owners with the open door right there. They'll be waiting to talk to him. And you'll see them talking to each other, and the sense of ownership is like palpable in the air. It's a very powerful cooperative culture. They also have created a sister business that has helped fuel their growth exponentially in recent years. And they started a nonprofit called PHI that takes the practices that this laboratory of Cooperative Home Care Associates innovates and applies to create these quality jobs that lead to quality care. And they teach other home care companies to do that through their consulting work. They also do lobbying and advocacy and have helped to raise state reimbursement rates for home care workers across the board in a state like New York. So that's an incredible victory that a cooperative was on the cutting edge of and something we should all be proud of. Opportunity Threads is a small worker co-op, only about 4 years old in Morganton, North Carolina, and they too have an industry strategy. North Carolina has lost 120,000 textile industry jobs between, I believe it was 1995 and 2010. Some of those jobs are now starting to come back, and there is a movement towards made in the USA. There's a number of sort of eco-fashion labels, and Opportunity Threads is producing, cutting and sewing for many of those labels across the country, and partnering with local producers as well. Their worker owners, they have almost 20 people working in the company now, and they not only have a very entrepreneurial and innovative and empowering day-to-day work culture, but they've also started to actually build assets. So they have a partnership with Self-Help Credit Union, and the retained earnings from the cooperative go into a savings account at Self-Help, and they have specific agreements about how those savings can be used, and therefore asset building, things that will really help build their wealth over time. So I recently learned from Molly Hemstreet, the manager at Opportunity Threads, that two of the worker owners have purchased homes in cash. Which, I live in California, so that's kind of unimaginable. But they've been able to do it. So very exciting what they're doing internally in this business. And they are the leading entity in a collaborative initiative called the Carolina Textile District, which is bringing together old guard, new guard, and everything in between in the value chain of the textile industry in North Carolina to revitalize it. So it's very, very exciting work. And just a quick word about New Era Windows. If you're familiar with them, or if you're not, Google, and you'll find some really interesting stories about how they got started. The factory that these workers were working in was suddenly shut down by the owner a few years back, and the last months of wages that the workers were owed were not paid until the union and the workers fought for it. Eventually, they did get that money. They tried to buy the company straight out, weren't able to, but later did manage to acquire a portion of that company and start New Era Windows. So I was able to visit them briefly last August on this day, and it was the day that they had pushed the most windows and doors out the door ever since they started. And they paid themselves based on production, very entrepreneurial. And that day they had made the equivalent of $20 an hour, which they told me was twice what they had ever made with their previous employer. So New Era Windows is an example of one of the common origin stories for worker cooperatives. I call it lemons to lemonade. It's basically coming out of crisis and workers getting together and starting it. Build a Better World is what I call worker cooperatives that started with some other social or environmental mission. So Equal Exchange, for example, was there to build the fair trade movement in this country and support small farmers. And for them, worker ownership was a natural fit for their business model, given their values. Pass It On is converting businesses. And that, as I said, is becoming a new trend. Started up is what I'm calling worker co-op development. So when you have a third-party developer, most of them are nonprofit, actually, but there is one, the Arizmendi Association, which is a federation of cooperatives that develops new co-ops as well. So most of the work in worker co-op development has been on startups until very recently. And yesterday there was a very exhilarating meeting of many organizations around the country that have already worked with worker co-op conversions, and great conversation about how we can work together to do more, and people doing other kinds of co-op conversions as well, as we've heard about with the manufactured home parks. On the startup side, just wanted to share some of the common models that are being practiced today. Cooperative Home Care Associates and Opportunity Threads are the best examples of what I call the industry transformation strategy, where the co-op development is something that's very important, but it's the cornerstone of a broader industry transformation strategy. The strategy that Wages had with the cleaning cooperatives and that Arizmendi has with the bakeries in the San Francisco Bay Area is sort of a franchise-like effort. So it's replicating cooperatives in the same industry in contiguous service areas, and that has also had some nice success. Newer models include the place-based clusters of diverse cooperatives like the Evergreen Co-ops in Cleveland. They have a laundry, they have a greenhouse, and they have a solar and electric company. So you can imagine those are very different businesses, and they're all focused in the same two or three neighborhoods of Cleveland that had been decimated during the Rust Belt. So another interesting initiative. There's engagement with anchor institutions, which is a new trend a lot of regions are getting interested in. And finally, there are more and more co-op academies springing up, which I consider more of an educational model than a full-on development model. But some of us, including a coalition that my organization is part of in the Bay Area, are developing worker co-op academies, trying to integrate some of the success factors from the co-op development examples that we've seen, like having sort of more strategic business support and coaching and ongoing technical assistance. So from studying and really sitting with and analyzing these models, I was able to pull out 10 success factors. The first, I would say, are really, what's your approach to development? And there were three aspects of that I thought were important. One is being really good at developing businesses and being really good at developing people. So a lot of nonprofits are coming into worker co-op development out of social work or out of community organizing, and you know, often are great at developing people and building up those collaboration skills and organizing, but haven't ever started businesses before. So as you can imagine, that's a challenge. Most businesses fail, so we got to take this really seriously. And then there's some examples also of people coming in and really saying, yeah, we got to make this business work. That's the first and foremost priority, and not always being able to sort of build up the human development as strongly as they might want to simultaneously. So being able to do those things really well, having that capacity, is the first success factor. There's no way around the industry focus. We heard about it from Kevin, the Wages example, Arizmendi, and the others I've mentioned actually all have specialties in their industries. I think it's obvious why that's a powerful. You don't have to relearn a new industry every time you start a new co-op. And finally, the long-term support. It's already been spoken to. I think the dentist spoke to, they thought it was going to be 2 years, but it was often more like 5 years to develop the senior housing co-ops. That was exactly the experience of Wages with the cleaning co-ops. And being in it for that long term, and also taking the leadership role that I believe a developer should, of bringing not only best practices, but bringing the capacity that you know is going to be needed to get that business going, and bringing worker owners into that process, and over time, you know, transitioning, the developer's role will fade back as the co-op gets more mature and stable. Training is our fifth principle. We all know that that's critical, so having that in an ongoing way is critical. Good governance, I'm sure we all know a lot about this, and one of the factors that I saw in the examples that I looked at was that part of the governance that was working for cooperative home care and the Wages cooperatives, for example, was having non-worker owners on the boards of directors with a vote and providing some leadership to that board. I know that can be controversial in some co-op sectors and probably means different things in different environments, but it was definitely a success factor for those two examples. Resources. Kevin made a great case. We know that we need more of them because this work does need to be subsidized for the same reasons that other kinds of community economic development are subsidized by the government or philanthropically. So building out a patient capital ecosystem that includes the right kind of loans, that includes equity vehicles, and grants, and now community capital is emerging as a new form of finance that is becoming more popular among co-ops. But having enough capital and of the right kind, of course, is a success factor. The Arizmendi cooperatives have done a great job of having shared business services throughout their 7 bakeries, and that's been really important for them. And finally, the issue of people and culture. So we've heard some references to management in the success stories we've heard so far. And in worker co-ops, there's can tend to be a sort of anti-management initial orientation, and sometimes that has worked for some of our larger worker co-ops to not have sort of formal management positions, but to have other ways of doing the management roles of the business. But in worker co-op development in lower income communities for community economic development purposes and job creation, we found that having strong management of a really good person with the skills already to build that business has met the goal of the worker owners much better, of getting them full-time jobs, getting them a thriving business that they can govern and participate in and work in every day. Of course, you need the right person to do that, and that's one of the challenges of this work. So you can't be a command and control manager. It's just not going to work. So we want participation. We want leadership distributed at different levels of a cooperative organization, of course. So leadership at all levels that can bring out leadership in others is important. And finally, I'm calling this the X factor. There is this issue of, for lack of a better term, I'm calling social entrepreneurs. And what I mean by that is a uniquely entrepreneurial, effective, humble, and multi-talented individual. In the stories that I've shared today, I won't go through and name them. It's not the point who they are. And probably many of the people who will be coming into our Hall of Fame later today and others in the room would probably fit the same description. But in all of these success stories, there has been one, two, or three individuals without whom I think that success wouldn't have happened at the same pace or necessarily happened at all. So just to use Cooperative Home Care Associates as an example, Rick Serpin was originally the developer, and eventually they were like, we gotta get you in there because our other managers aren't working out. And he went in and built that thing. And then he went in and built the sister company that built it even more. Steve Dawson, who was the first worker cooperator to join the Hall of Fame here, he was inducted a couple years ago, was another key person, as well as Peggy Powell. Their longevity, their talent, their humility, all of those things are really critical to that success. So I don't know what we do with that, except be aware of it and just think about how can we all develop that, those capacities in ourselves? How can we develop it in other people? Just a quick snapshot of how I roughly lined up these success factors against the four examples that I gave. We won't spend time drilling into this, but what I wanted to share with you is this, that four of them did go across all four of those examples. The others are also extremely important, but to me it was just, that's helpful to know that as we look at doing worker cooperative development at scale, these are things we need to be building into the model. Now, Kevin and I didn't really compare notes, but like him, I'm gonna take a moment to say, why does this even matter? I mean, it's cool, I'm telling you some nice stories, but is it really, why is it important? The first reason it matters is that it works. It makes a difference in communities. So I already told you the story of Berto's cooperative and the increases in family incomes. By the time I left wages, the year after I left in 2012, their impact study showed that the Oakland cooperative members, their incomes, the family income had increased by 80%. So it's powerful, it works. And they had thousands of dollars of internal savings in their internal capital accounts, which most of these low-income families had never had before. Not to mention, you know, no interest loans and other types of programs that help them maintain their stability and get out of poverty. Cooperative Home Care Associates has very low turnover, an industry with high turnover, 15 versus 40 to 60%. We know that worker ownership and cooperative models are good for business as well. I was just reviewing the latest State of the Sector report from the Democracy at Work Institute, and they looked at profitability. And they found that the worker cooperatives who responded to that part of the survey, it was about 100 worker co-ops, were between 2 and 6% more profitable than typical profitability in their industries. So that was really interesting to see. I'd seen one data point before from the plywood cooperatives in the Northwest that they were 4 to like 16% or something more efficient than other plywood businesses. But it's really exciting to have this new information that suggests that the way we work is actually better for business. And finally, two examples of how it's better for society. So someone recently said to me, you know, worker cooperatives are a little bit of a different animal because they're really about benefiting those members primarily. And it's, of course, they're about benefiting those members, but they tend to have impact much beyond their business and much beyond their membership, and also many of them have broader missions. One example, this is actually from the ESOP world, but I think could carry over, is that employee owners were more likely to vote in the 2008 elections than non-employee owners, 10% more likely, which was interesting. And I would love to encourage all of you to read the next data point, the study that has the data point that I'm citing last here, which was by David Ertl. It was his PhD thesis. He's an employee ownership practitioner in, I believe, Scotland. And he compared three towns in northern Italy, which is one of the regions of the world with more cooperatives and more worker ownership than anywhere else. One with 26% employee ownership, one with zero, and one with something in between. And he looked at 19 social and economic indicators, ranging from health to education to, income. I don't remember what they all are, of course, but on 17 of 19 of those, the town with more worker ownership fared much better. So what he says then is that employee ownership is good for your health. It's good for our communities. Now, if it can do all of these good things, here's why we need to scale it up, because we need these things. Our economy is not working for most people, as Kevin so eloquently stated. A couple of specific examples related to low-wage workers. So wage stagnation. Wages have stayed almost flat since the 70s, even though profits have doubled, or profitability has doubled. Productivity, I'm sorry, in businesses in this country. Wages are now a smaller portion of GDP than they ever have been in since GDP has been measured. And actually, corporate profits are a much higher percentage of GDP than they've ever been before. So this gap is just not making sense. And working poor has become kind of a normal thing. It should be an oxymoron, but it's a term that we're pretty used to, and it is the reality of a lot of our working people. Income inequality, it's not good for any of us. Of course, it's worse for the people at the bottom, but it's bad for everybody. And I love this graphic from Robert Reich's movie, Inequality for All, which just shows that when inequality peaked twice, the economy crashed. It peaked right before the Great Depression and right before the Great Recession. It hasn't come down, as that second arrow might indicate, but the point is clear that inequality just doesn't work for anybody. And finally, as Kevin mentioned, the wealth gap. He described it as sort of the great issue of our time that we have to solve, and I would agree. It's bigger than the income gap, and it has racial dimensions to it that I think, you know, are not unrelated to the problems we're seeing in Baltimore and Ferguson and Oakland and other places in this country. In the Great Recession, white Americans lost 11% of their wealth, and that was a heavy hit. African Americans lost 31%, and Latinos lost 44%. So that racial wealth gap got much wider. There we are. And what that's meant a few years on is that, well, just to compare white and African American wealth, white households used to have a median wealth of 8 times that of African Americans in 2010. And now by 2013, it's actually gone up to 13 times. So this problem is getting worse, and we need something that can address not only the poor quality of a lot of jobs for low-wage workers today, but also the wealth challenge and the way that most companies and most jobs don't give workers an opportunity to also build wealth. So worker cooperatives can do that. I believe they can be a meaningful part of addressing these issues, which are important for our society. I'm going to quickly wrap up by sharing some of what's new and how many of us in the worker cooperative sector are thinking about scale at this point. So we've learned a lot of lessons about the worker cooperative initiatives that have gotten to something closer to scale. It's all very modest, and we need to make it much bigger to truly call it scale. But one of the ways that we're thinking about it is moving beyond thinking of worker co-op development as just the co-op and the developer, right, and the people involved, but thinking on a systems level about entrepreneurial ecosystems. And the Democracy at Work Institute and my organization, Project Equity, have co-developed a framework called a cooperative growth ecosystem framework, looking at 5 different entrepreneurial ecosystem frameworks and some coming out of the social enterprise sector as well, and really calling out how different actors in a place can help support the growth of worker cooperatives. There's also new collaboration happening in many places around the country. You've probably heard that the New York City Council allocated $1.2 million for worker co-op development. And that coalition is waiting for the approval of the next amount for this year, which they think will be significantly higher. In Madison, the city council has also approved $1 million per year for 5 years to invest into worker cooperatives. So these are things we've never seen before, and they're exciting. Philadelphia and Austin have cooperative business associations that include worker cooperatives and other kinds of cooperatives, so new initiatives around cooperation among cooperatives. And in the San Francisco Bay Area, we're starting to get together as a cooperative community and to bring in government and other types of businesses and educational players to start to build our ecosystem locally. And finally, I've already mentioned conversions, but that's definitely a very exciting trend to keep your eye on. And I'll just quickly provide a little bit more detail about each of these. I won't go through this one by one, but these are the 11 elements of the ecosystem framework that we've developed. And we've applied it to 5 regions around the country, and in the next week or so, we're going to be talking with people in those regions who we've already interviewed, but really getting their feedback on how we're sort of rating and preparing scorecards for the ecosystem as a way to think about what do we have, what are we missing, and how do we therefore build out our strategy. But the thing to note here is that those success factors that we learned from worker co-op development are really integrated into this ecosystem. So you'll see growth-oriented co-op developers as an essential component. Developers with that business capacity as well as human development capacity. The management pieces included there in skills and talent, as well as the training and the skills of the worker ownership in general. And of course, technical assistance and the financing, which I already spoke about. I won't walk through the others, but you can see that we're thinking about how any player in a local economy can contribute to the development of this kind of effort. This is a picture from our Worker Co-op Academy in Oakland, our graduation of our first class last December. And it was hosted at our community college, which is now going to be offering our academy as a fee-based course. And we're hoping that that's the first stepping stone to Laney College, then spreading throughout their community college system, which includes, I can't remember how many, but a number of other community colleges around the state. And the question that we're asking ourselves locally is, how can we scale up worker ownership locally? Because we do believe that, and I think we've seen it in the examples shared today outside the worker co-op sector, that when you get some level of critical mass, it starts to become easier and more normal. And in the worker co-op sector, we're just beginning to really imagine how we can do that systematization and standardization that has been so beneficial in the other models we talked about today. So our answer so far is let's work on multiple pathways. Let's support small-scale startups, and let's have a real strategy for larger-scale startups that will be designed for growth. Let's also develop a major new initiative on co-op conversions, which we're working on. We've put out a number of tools already, and Project Equity's planning for a business conversions incubator that we plan to launch later this year. And then I've already spoken about engaging diverse stakeholders to develop the ecosystem. And finally, just a word about conversions. So we all know that baby boomers are retiring. What I didn't know until recently is that it's 10,000 of them a day across the country. It's a lot of people retiring. And baby boomers own 2/3 of the businesses in this country that employ people. And as you probably know, they basically don't have succession plans. Only about 15%, it's estimated, of business owners have succession plans, or I'm sorry, have a next family generation member to hand it down to. But in general, succession planning is just not happening in the way it needs to in the business sector. And so there is a real risk and an opportunity here, because many, many businesses will be changing hands. And we see that as a chance to introduce employee ownership to hopefully some meaningful number of those. So finally, I want to just issue an invitation and some food for thought for all of us. So Kevin spoke about the 1,000 jobs that have been created in the new food cooperatives. Wow, 1,000 jobs. From a worker co-op perspective, that's really exciting. So what if some of those co-ops were to consider having a multi-stakeholder co-op and having a worker member class within their food cooperative? And there's very few that are doing it. I know it's not a simple thing, but cooperatives have never shied away from a challenge. Now here's another one, purchasing co-ops. Thousands of individually held businesses are active, enthusiastic cooperative members, whether it's Ace Hardware or Carpet One or the many other ones that are out there. And what if they considered, what if those cooperatives helped those business owners think about the full spectrum of business succession options, including employee ownership? I would think that some of them might want to incorporate that into their businesses. What if we had a cooperative business alliance in every city and even rural areas? And as Kevin said, what if some of the wealth that our cooperatives are generating were going into investing in low-income communities through worker co-op development? That's an exciting opportunity as well. And finally, what if you fill in the blank? So leave you with that food for thought and just a few words from the friends that I've mentioned today. So Berta from EcoCare would not have become a business owner on her own, but she now is a full-fledged co-business owner. And that's brought out her talent, and it's brought out her passion and her satisfaction, as well as improved the economy of her family. We know that it's also good for society. It's good for our health, as David Ertl says. And finally, I'll just end with my favorite cooperative mantra. And I just learned in preparing for this talk that it was Aristotle who said it. But the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, and I think that's the opportunity today before us as a cooperative community to think about how we can all work together to address some of the challenges in our economy and to create a more cooperative future. Thank you.